Let me ask you, if you would, to do something for me so that we can come and get ourselves back on track. We haven't been here for a while. We're looking at this book of 2 Chronicles. So I'm going to ask you to keep your finger there at chapter 12 and go back to chapter 7 just for a moment so we can fix in our mind what we have already looked at. Look at verse 11. Thus Solomon finished the house of the Lord and the king's house and all that Solomon had planned to do in the house of the Lord and in his own house he successfully accomplished. Then the Lord appeared to Solomon in the night and said to him, I have heard your prayer and have chosen this place for myself as a house of sacrifice. When I shut up the heavens so that there is no rain or command, and the locust devours the land or send pestilence to the people, if my people, who are called by my name, humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven. I will forgive their sin and heal their land. Again, listen to this, verse 13. When I shut up the heavens, there is no rain. I command the locusts to devour the land, send pestilence among my people. If my people, called by my name, humble themselves and pray and seek my face, turn from their wicked ways, then I'll hear from heaven, I'll forgive their sin, I'll heal the land. The grass withers and the flower fades, God's word abides forever. By his grace and his mercy, may his word be preached for you. Please be seated. So I'm going to ask you to look with me in just a moment in chapter 12, but I want to do something before I do that. Now, in our study of revival, we have established our theme verse, Psalm 85:6, revive us again, O Lord. We have examined revival to try to bring a definition of revival. And that definition of revival was pretty simple, but I believe accurate, that revival is an extraordinary work of God's grace. It is an extraordinary work of God's grace through ordinary people in ordinary places by ordinary means with extraordinary consequences for God's glory. It's an extraordinary work. In revival, God brings life from death. But he uses ordinary people. He uses ordinary people like the son of a pub owner. The man's name's George Whitfield. Like the son of a rural, quote, unsuccessful pastor. His name's John Wesley. A missionary on the frontier of America, a missionary to the Indians, Jonathan Edwards. Ordinary people in ordinary places, Northampton. Globe, England. Ordinary people in ordinary places with ordinary means, preaching, evangelism, prayer, fellowship, worship, to do extraordinary things. He takes skeletons and makes them into armies. He takes dry bones and raises them up as soldiers of the living God. Invincibly and relentlessly moving with the weapons of the Spirit to extend the kingdom of God. His church revived, doing its great work. And whenever revival comes, we've already studied, if you haven't been with us, there were two evidences of revival that we've noticed in our study. There are 28 revival narratives in your Bible. I think you could argue for more than that, but at least 28. And as we have started to study them from our theme verse of Psalm 85:6, we've noted two evidences. One is a foundational evidence. The foundational evidence of a God-sent revival is God-centered worship. The foundational evidence of God-sent revival is God-centered worship. That's the vertical. When God revives, his people start worshiping him. God, not worship-centered worship. God-centered worship. Trinitarian God-centered worship. Praise the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit as we give praise to God in spirit and in truth. But not only that, there's a horizontal dynamic. God-sent revivals lead to gospel harvests. Gospel harvests that are secured by God the Father through the work of God the Son, by the power, presence, and authority of God the Spirit. Authority of God the Spirit. The Bible says, pray to the Lord of the harvest. Who is the Lord of the harvest? The Holy Spirit. He is the Lord of the harvest. He sends the workers into the harvest. He gives the fruit of the harvest to the workers. So when God brings revival, His people look up in worship and they look out with the gospel, and a harvest of souls starts to come from the nation where God is reviving His church. Our nation needs that awakening. Therefore, it needs a revived church. God bring revival, yet we notice this is God's work. You don't work up revival. I was raised in a church. Every spring we had revival week. We scheduled revival. Now, I'm not real negative on that. I actually believe you can schedule the seeking of revival. I think you can schedule preaching for revival. I think you can schedule praying for revival. In fact, let me just be honest with you. When we I'm always honest with you. Let me put it this way. Let me be clear about this. Let me be very clear about this. When we plan worship, we ask God every Lord's Day for revival. That's what we're asking for. The Lord's Supper is designed for revival, as we saw last week. So I don't think there's any problem for that, but revival isn't worked up. It has to come down. It is the power of the breath of God. I like the way G. Campbell Morgan said it. Now, if you don't know who he is, he was an excellent preacher. His heart was for revival, and he actually followed a pastor that the Lord used in a revival in London. He followed a man by the name of Martin Lloyd-Jones at Westminster Chapel in London. And when he was preaching on revival, he made the comment, revive thy work. Revival is your work. God, revival is your work in your people that they will praise you and reach the lost around them with a gospel harvest. So revive thy work, O Lord. And we can't work up revival. Revival must be sent by God and must come down from God. But I do believe with G. Campbell Morgan, I cannot send revival. You and I can't send revival, but we can hoist the sail. We're not the wind of God. We're not the breath of God. We're not the power of God, but we can hoist the sail. In fact, I believe even more than that. I believe God has given us the four-corner design of the sail that we hoist. And we've already studied it. Now, when we finish our study of revival, we will not only have expounded various texts of Scripture, we will have walked our way through 2 Chronicles, and we, by God's grace, at the end of this year, will walk our way through 1 Peter. But in 2 Chronicles, which is where we're going to be for a couple of weeks here, we have already seen where God gave the design for revival. It's in 2 Chronicles chapter 7 and verse 14. He says this, notice he didn't say if, when I bring my hand of discipline upon my people, and there is no rain, the locusts are there, the pestilence is there. When I bring my hand upon my people, and my people are in despair, my people are in distress, and my people are in that condition, and they're wondering, is there any hope? When I do that to my people with my hand of loving discipline, because they have walked away from me, I am dealing with them. When I do that, if by my strength and power and grace they come to their senses, and then if my people who are in that condition, if they will, four things. Here's your four corners of the sail we hoist. If they will humble themselves, if they will pray, if they will turn from their wicked ways, and if they seek me, then I will hear. He gives three promises. I will hear, I will forgive their sin, and I will heal them. I will hear them, I will forgive them, and I will heal them. Now, I love the book of Chronicles. When was it written? Well, we don't know for sure, but we believe it was written not all that long after the revival we've already studied in Nehemiah. The book of Chronicles, now let me put it this way. Now, I know Chronicles is a little bit of a downer for you. I'll explain it. January comes, and Pastor Reeder encourages you to consider reading through the Bible, and you decide, okay, I'll read through the Bible this year. And you start reading through the Bible. Genesis, man, this is good. Exodus, oh, adventure, this is good. Leviticus, whew. Numbers. That's usually where reading through the Bible dies every year, Numbers. But somehow you make it by Numbers, and you're Deuteronomy. Okay, back to adventure. Now we got it going again. And then you get to Joshua. Now that's big time adventure. And then Judges. Well, you start working, and then you get to 1 and 2 Samuel. And then you kind of notice 1 and 2 Kings sure is repeating a lot of 1 and 2 Samuel. And then you get to 1 and 2 Chronicles, and you say 1 and 2 Chronicles is repeating 1 and 2 Samuel and 1 and 2 Kings. My goodness, it's hard enough to get through all of these genealogies and kings and prophets to begin with. Now I got to do it three different times. Well, actually, there's a little bit more to it than just repetition. There's some things that are being done, information that's being added, repetition for certain purposes and all of that. But Chronicles was written after Israel, after the two southern tribes, Judah and Benjamin, which had been taken into Babylonian captivity, after they had been set free. And they've come back. And when they got back to the land, they languished. But then God sent a revival under Nehemiah. They built the wall. They built the city. They built the temple. They restored the sacrifices. And a great revival broke out. We studied it as we saw the great worship that took place in that revival. Well, now they are again in disrepair under the hand of God's judgment. And they're in need of revival. So the writer of Chronicles, in 1 and 2 Chronicles, goes back in history. And he brings them as to how God had established his people under King David. And 1 Chronicles focuses upon God's hand of blessing working in and through the ordinary yet extraordinary work of God through David at various times, even working with him in his sin and restoring him, and then working in the lives of his people, and then in his son Solomon, and using his son Solomon to extend the kingdom to its borders and to establish it and to put his house there and the king's house there. And now they've built it, and the Shekinah glory comes down and fills the temple. And then God says, now, when I bring my hand of judgment, not if, when, you are going to walk away from me. When that happens, you need to get back to me. So if my people who are called by my name will, one, humble themselves, two, pray, three, turn from your wicked way, four, seek my face, then, if that, then I will hear, forgive, and heal. That's what will happen. So these are not four things we do to bring revival down. These are the four things God works in the lives of his people when he's sending revival down. What is my responsibility? Hoist the sail. Humble myself. Pray. Turn from my wicked ways. Seek his face. So that we learn that. The chronicler then says, I'm going to show you how God fulfilled this promise in the history of his people. The revival he brings in the descendants of David in 2 Chronicles. And the rest of 2 Chronicles are five revivals. Each revival incorporates, now hang with me, y'all. Each revival incorporates those four design elements of revival. Humble yourself, pray, seek his face, turn from your wicked ways. Each revival incorporates those, but each revival clearly emphasizes one of them. Well, you say, no, wait a minute, Harry. You got five revivals. You just said each one incorporates all five, but each one emphasizes one of the four, but you got five revivals, but you only got these four elements that he has in the design for revival, that God puts out in the design for revival. So how does that work? One of them, this is ingenious. One of them he repeats twice. Guess which one he repeats twice? The first one. Humble yourself. The first revival under Rehoboam is focused on humbling yourself. The last revival under Josiah, which is what I was going to preach on today, but decided to do Rehoboam. If God's going to put it in there, I need to preach on it. The last revival under Josiah emphasizes humble yourself. The other three revivals in between emphasize prayer, seek his face, and turn from your wicked ways. So we're walking through all five of those, and we're starting with Rehoboam. Now, why would God, when he emphasizes these four elements of revival, why would he emphasize humility? Well, for the same reason he puts it first. Humility is crucial. It is absolutely essential. You can't pray till you humble yourself. You won't pray till you humble yourself. You will not seek him till you humble yourself. You will not turn from your wicked ways. You won't even call him wicked until you humble yourself. Each one of these build, and you start with humility. And now the chronicler is saying, this is not only, he says, I want you to think of revival as a sandwich. Here's the three slices in between. Turn from your wicked ways, pray, and seek my face. And then I'm putting two great slices of bread, double fiber, on both sides. It's called humble yourself. I'm going to put it in a sandwich for you. And you're going to get to see it at the beginning with Rehoboam. You're going to see it at the end. I want to start with it. I want to make sure you get it when you walk away, as well as the other three in between. Now, why does he do that? Here's why. Because what is the opposite of humility? Pride. Arrogance. What is pride? It is the mother sin. They all flow from it. Satan knows it. That's why, what is his scheme? What is Satan's scheme? The lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, the boastful pride of life. It worked in the garden, and it's worked with every son and daughter of Adam ever since then. Lust of the flesh. When Eve saw that the tree was good for food. Lust of the eyes. It was a delight to the eyes. Boastful pride of life. Lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, boastful pride of life. It was desirable to make her wise. She could be like God. You know, isn't that a really interesting? Do you see how pride and arrogance makes you think with pure stupidity and without accuracy? Because Satan comes to her and says, listen, God's lying to you about this fruit because he knows the day you eat it, you'll know good and evil and you'll be like God. All Eve had to say was, so what? I already am like him. In fact, I've been made in his image. What you're really trying to sell me is not be like God. You're really trying to sell me to be God. That everything begins and ends and revolves around me. And that's the mother of every sin. And let me give you another reason why we're dealing with humility. Not only because it combats pride, which is the mother sin, and keeps us from doing what we're supposed to do, boasting in the Lord because we're too busy boasting about ourselves. It also is confronted in the Bible with very clear language. God is opposed to the proud, but gives grace to the humble. You'll find that in Proverbs chapter 3. You'll also find it in James 4:6. You'll also find it in 1 Peter chapter 5. James and Peter will repeat it. James will say it very clearly. He'll say this. He'll say to us, he said, what is the source of quarrels and envies and all the disputes among you as my people? Let me tell you what it is. It's pride. That's what it is. And I want you to know something. God is opposed to the proud, but God gives grace to the humble. Therefore, humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, and he will exalt you at the right time. Don't exalt yourself and pray for humility. Humble yourself and then trust him. He'll exalt you at the right time. Well, he then goes on to, and then Peter does the same thing. He says to the elders to shepherd the flock of God among you, and then he calls us to submission, and then he calls us to humility, and he repeats the same text. The scripture says, God is opposed to the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Please look at that. What is God's posture to the proud? What is it? Opposition. Now, I love a passage of scripture. If God be for us, who can be against us? But if God is against me, this is no match. I am not interested in God being opposed to me. I want God to be for me. But I know that God is opposed to the proud. I know you say, Harry, you're saying that you've got to do these things to be saved. That's not what I'm saying. I'm talking about a life before God. A life before God realizes God does not pet or embrace or allow pride to stand. He's opposed to it. Even in his people. If my people are called by my name and humble themselves. Why do they need to humble themselves? Because they've been proud. And when they got proud, what happened? I sent the pestilence. I sent the rain. I withheld the rain. I did all of that because I am opposed to the proud. Even when my people are prideful, I'm not going to leave them there. I'm going to deal with them. So if we want the full movement of God's presence, then we have to have a commitment to humble ourselves. Did you realize that this verb in the Hebrew, in your Old Testament, translated humble yourself, is there 36 times? 36 times. And almost half of them are in the Chronicles. And most of those are found in these revivals, including this first one. I want you to look with me in 2 Chronicles chapter 12. Let's look at it in three categories. God is opposed to the proud. God gives grace to the humble. And God gives a greater grace. God's grace is greater than our sin. Look with me in chapter 12 and verse 1. Now, wait just a minute. Let me tell you what's happened. Solomon's dead. His son Rehoboam, who is the grandson of David, is now king. And things aren't going well. The 10 northern tribes are in rebellion against the line of David under a guy by the name of Jeroboam. They're in rebellion. So Rehoboam says, you know what? I'm going to try to stop this rebellion. So he sat down with his elders. He sat down with the people from the 10 tribes that were in rebellion. He said, what's the problem? They said, listen, your father put a heavy hand on us, a heavy hand of military rule, a heavy hand of oppression, and a heavy hand of taxation. If you will lift that heavy hand, then we will serve you as king. So he then goes to his elders, and he says, can you give me counsel? And the elders say, well, this is what they said, if you lift their hand. And by the way, King Solomon was heavy-handed with them. So why don't you lift your hand and take that off of them so that they will stay with you? We believe they will. Well, Rehoboam, after he heard that counsel, went over to his young men. He left the older men, and he went to the young men. He said, what do you think? And they said, are you kidding me? If you do that, they will be emboldened to take everything from you. Here's what you tell them. I am king. Now, this is a little paraphrase, but I'm close. I am King Rehoboam. I am grandson of David, son of Solomon. And if you think Solomon's hand was heavy, my little finger is as big as his thigh. You've not seen anything yet. So that became his dictate. And 10 tribes walked away in rebellion. And then after the 10 tribes walked away in rebellion, he not only had a civil war going on and a rebellion, but this guy from Egypt, this king from Egypt comes up named Shishak. And he shows up with about 160,000 men and 12,000 or 1,200 chariots. So let's see how that happens and what do we learn from this. Here's the first thing I want you to see. God is opposed to the proud. Look at verses 1 through 5 of chapter 12. When the rule of Rehoboam was established, that he was strong, he abandoned the law of the Lord and all Israel with him. In the fifth year of King Rehoboam, because they had been unfaithful to the Lord, Shishak, king of Egypt, came up against Jerusalem with 1,200 chariots, 60,000 horsemen, and the people were without number who came with him from Egypt, Libyans, Suklim, and Ethiopians. And he took the fortified cities of Judah and came as far as Jerusalem. Then Shemaiah, the prophet, came to Rehoboam and to the princes of Judah who had gathered at Jerusalem because of Shishak and said to them, thus says the Lord, you abandoned me, so I have abandoned you to the hand of Shishak. Now, all right, so what's happened here? Here's what's happened. He has, in arrogance, said to the 10 tribes, my finger is thicker than Solomon's thigh. And they walked away. So what did he do? Well, if you go back and read chapter 10, 11, he raised up a big army from the tribes of Benjamin and Judah. He secured Benjamin and Judah. He secured Jerusalem. And he had this big army. Then he went out and he got all of the priests to come in and sign his promotion celebrity brochure. All of the priests signed on to support King Rehoboam. And they went out throughout all the land and said, everybody ought to support King Rehoboam. So now he has secured Judah. He has secured Benjamin. He has secured Jerusalem. He has this gigantic army. He has all of the priests signed on to him, and he marries his cousin, another relative of David, to secure everything. Rehoboam became strong and secured himself and walked away from the Lord. Why do I need him? I have secured myself. And he walked away from the Lord. And now he's got this rebellion inside. And now he finds out this guy Shishak just showed up with all of these horsemen and all of these chariots. And the Bible tells you why he showed up. You know, I kind of moonlight as a historian. And I love to read what the historians say, the secular historians about Shishak. They said they give the reasons Shishak came up to Jerusalem. And then they give the reasons why Shishak did not take Jerusalem. And but God tells you the story behind the story. Do you know why Shishak's up there? Shishak said, I'm coming up there. I'm having to be careful with this name. Y'all pray for me. Shishak, that's not an easy name to do 30 times in a row. Shishak has showed up. And now everybody tell you, it's for power, it's to extend the territory, and it's to get the money and control the two crossroads of the world. That's what he's doing there. No, he's there because God sent him up there to bring judgment upon his people. That's why he's there. Shishak is here because you have abandoned me, is what the text says. And you have abandoned me because you're strong. You have secured yourself. So you walked away from me and my word and my worship, and now I have brought Shishak to you. So Shemaiah, the prophet, declares, this is why Shishak is there, because you have abandoned the Lord. Now look at, and so that, by the way, can we just stop here just for a minute? Here is Rehoboam, who is now proud. He has secured himself. He is proud. He has secured himself. And because he is proud, he doesn't need the Lord. He's walked away from God. He's walked away from God's word. He's walked away from worship. I mean, his word and worship, that's okay if it kind of fits my schedule, but it doesn't fit my schedule right now. And by the way, why do I need him? I've secured myself. I don't need God. I am securing myself. Well, God's opposed to the proud. And now you're seeing the opposition that God's bringing inside and from the outside. But let me ask you a question. When are you and I on the verge of putting ourselves in the position of opposition by God because of our pride. Can I tell you when? We are most likely to pride when we are successful in life. Look who I got as my wife. Look at my army. Look at my priest. I'm actually believing what everybody's saying about me. I've got the whole thing secured. That's when you and I are. When you paint that picture and everybody oohs and ahs over it. When you close that deal. When you see the bottom line is tripling at business. You got the good grades. You won the award. That's a dangerous moment. Dangerous moment. And our very successes, you know why? Because each one of us are born with a sin nature. And when you're saved, you still got that old man. You know what that default is? It's all about me. That's the default. It's all about me. It comes from me. It's for me. It's unto me. It's all about me. I am the center of everything. And your child is born with that. You and I were born with that. I'm not much on computers. Everybody knows that. Let me admit it again. I'm not much on computers, but I do know this. I turn the thing on, and there's something that appears on the screen. Every day when I get up, let me tell you what appears on my screen. It's all about you. You can solve it. You can do it. You can secure yourself. You can save yourself. So I don't need a message of grace. I can handle it. And then many of us, and I love you. I hope you still love me after I say this. Please try to love me. Just let me hang on, because I'm going to beat myself up in just a minute. But just a minute. That's something I need to tell us. Those children you and I got, they come with a blessing. I'll be a God to you and to your children after you. But these covenant children are covenant vipers in diapers. And they're born with that default system. It's all about me. And many of us as parents, for our own ego, feed it. So they become bumper sticker material for us. We're really, it's all about us, but we're putting there, and we are feeding that self-oriented, self-confidence, self-absorption in the life of our children. Now, we may do it in the name of self-esteem when we ought to be teaching self-respect, which comes in a right relationship with God. But what we're doing is feeding that in the life of our child, which they already have a default system. It's all about me. And then we revolve the whole family around them. We revolve everything that happens around them. And then we ask God, God, while we exalt our children, would you come and maybe humble them a little bit enough to get them saved? When in reality, we ought to help them see the blessing of hoisting the sail and humble yourself. Have you noticed humility is not a prayer request in the Bible? Now, you can pray for it. You and I can pray for humility. When you pray for humility, duck. It's amazing what comes next. But the Bible actually gives it as an action step. I will put my spirit within you and enable you to humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. My power will give you the ability to humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. And by the way, one of the successes where you and I are most vulnerable is our spiritual successes. Got my quiet time every day. I've got my quiet time every day. I tithe. I share the gospel. I am praying for revival. I never miss worship. Now, actually, everything I just said to you, praise God. But actually, we turned it into, praise me. Wherever you are, any success in life, artists, academics, athletics, God's Grace, when it's there, allows you to see, I wouldn't be where I am and doing what I am without the grace of God. I am what I am by the grace of God. That's true in everything in life, and it's doubly true if God is giving you spiritual victories in life. It is doubly true. Y'all have heard the story. I like the way my friend Sandy Wilson talks about it. When you walk through a field, if there's a fence post and a turtle on it, you know what? I'm not the first one in this field. You know that. Well, folks, you and me are turtles on a fence post. Wherever we are in our relationship with God, businessmen, businesswomen, students, athletes, artists, wherever we are, and in our spiritual life, we're on that fence post because God put us there. And if we're on that fence post, praise God. But the tendency is to praise ourselves and to put our confidence in ourselves and to compare ourselves to other people instead of praising God for what he's done in our life. And let me tell you, so now, remember what I said? Boom, here it is. Can I tell you, I have really been convicted where I am. I mean, right here I stand, raised platform, pulpit, hundreds of people looking at me. Spotlights shining on me. 4 cameras following me. Boy, you must be something. We are always on the edge at the moments of God's greatest blessings of turning them into cursings because we think it's about us and for us and from us and because of us. We've got to ask God, give me the grace to humble myself. You're opposed to the proud, and I am never more dangerously close to pride than in my successes in life, in any and every area. Well, let me do this, and I'm done. Secondly, go to the next verses. I'll be done in just a minute. Chapter 12, go down to verse 6. God is not only opposed to the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Look what happens in verse 6. Then the princes of Israel and the king humbled themselves and said, the Lord is righteous, not us. We're not our Savior. The Lord is righteous. The princes and the kings humbled themselves and said, the Lord is righteous. And when the Lord saw they humbled themselves, the word of the Lord came to Shemaiah. They have humbled themselves. I will not destroy them, but I will grant them some deliverance, and my wrath shall not be poured out on Jerusalem by the hand of Shishak. Nevertheless, they shall be servants to him, so that they may know my service and the service of the kingdom of the countries. So now God gives grace to the humble. They humble themselves, and what does God do? He gives them, did you see the text? Some deliverance. Now, why didn't he give them complete deliverance? Well, folks, it's the same thing with you. Have you been set free from sin's guilt and shame? And are you being set free from its practice? But you're not yet there. Why didn't God go ahead and deliver the whole package to us right now? He's given us title right to everything in Christ, but I'm not experiencing everything right now in Christ. Why not? Because he's perfecting us. He's not going to give them the whole deliverance. If we get the whole deliverance, guess where we're going to be back? We're going to be back at pride again. So he's going to keep some deliverance. And by the way, I'm going to keep Shishak right outside the door. I'm going to stop him. Because you humbled yourself. Now, all the historians say he stopped because he was running out of water. No, he got stopped because God stopped him. God brought him, God stopped him. That's the story behind the story. And God sent him because of their pride, and then God stopped them when they humbled themselves. And he gives them some deliverance and some reprieve, even though he keeps Shishak there in order to maintain their attention and their reliance on him and not reliance on their deliverance and their success. So he says in verse 9, so Shishak, So Shishak, king of Egypt, came up against Jerusalem. He took away the treasures of the house of the Lord and the treasures of the king's house. He took away everything. He also took away the shields of gold that Solomon had made, and King Rehoboam made in their place shields of bronze and committed them to the hands of the officers of the guard who kept the door of the king's house. And as often as the king went into the house of the Lord, the guard came and carried them and brought them back to the guard room. And when he humbled himself, the wrath of the Lord turned from him, so as not to make a complete destruction. Moreover, conditions were good in Judah. Praise the Lord. Revival. It comes. Now, don't you see what he's done? He said this, I'm going to give you some deliverance. But by the way, Shishak, go ahead and take those gold shields. Rehoboam, put some bronze shields. And every day, Rehoboam's got to answer, how come we don't have gold shields? Shishak took him. Why did Shishak take him? Because he came up here at the hand of God because of our pride. But we humbled ourselves, so at least we got bronze shields right now. So I tell you what, let's take care of these bronze shields for the Lord. Let's take care of them for the Lord. And let's put our trust in the Lord. That God gives a greater grace, and that is when he delivers us, he continues to grow us. He continues to grow us in our relationship with him, so that the root of pride doesn't get another grip. So here's your takeaway, and I'm done. Revival comes down. Here it is. Revival comes down to lift God's people up when they bow down to lift him up. So let me say it again. Revival comes down to lift God's people up when they bow down to lift him up. Brothers and sisters, it's fair for us to pray for humility, to pray for brokenness. But the objective is not brokenness. Brokenness is a corrective. The objective is to humble ourselves and exalt the Lord and lift him up. Then he will lift us up at the right time. And the reason that's true, and the reason you can depend on it and be assured of it, is because of what you said earlier. Have this mind in yourself, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped. But he emptied himself. He bowed down. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself to death on a cross. Therefore, God has exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow. Humble ourselves. He'll exalt us at the right time. My brothers and sisters, God has done much to save us, to sustain us, and to bless us. But he hasn't done much to save us, sustain us, and bless us to make much of us. He's done much to save us so that we could be set free to make much of him. Let's bow down. Our God has bowed down from the heavens to save us. Let's bow down and exalt him. Humble ourselves. Hoist the sail. That the wind of God would fill the sail and the church would rise up having bowed down before the Lord. Let's pray. Let's ask the Holy Spirit to speak to your heart. God, thank you so much for the time to be with my brothers and sisters. Lord, would you come to each of us that we would bow down and lift you up, knowing that you, when you are exalted, will exalt us at the right time. Father, thank you for the grace that allows us to humble ourselves. Thank you for the many victories in life. Thank you for our children. Thank you for the blessings. There's so much there, but we so easily turn those blessings into cursings when we think they came from us, for us, or because of us. May the blessings become one more reason to humble ourselves and say to the world, Jesus reigns. He is exalted. In Jesus' name, amen.